excited. She'll be starting her PhD in the Plant Biology and Conservation Program with Krista, actually, this fall, and she'll be studying the pollination and evolution of all Hawaiian hibiscus taxa. So I'll just now be presenting to you some preliminary results on our research investigating the pollination ecology of the critically endangered Hawaiian tree species, Hibiscus waimeae, subspecies hannerae. Just to set the stage, as most of you in this room probably know, Hawaii is a very special place for many reasons, one of them being the unique biodiversity that evolved there. Our native invertebrates and birds are very unique and diverse, as well as our flora. We're commonly referred to as one of the world's biodiversity hotspots. Our native flowering plant species are composed of over 1,000 of them, and we have a very high rate of endemism. About 90% of them are endemic. Unfortunately, our Hawaiian flora is also very threatened and endangered. We're also sometimes called the endangered species capital of the world. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service lists 499 Hawaiian plant and animal species as threatened or endangered, and 85% of those are plants, 422 species. So the urgency with which we need to work together to protect them is quite apparent. NTBG, where I work, and as well as many other agencies and organizations across the state, is implementing the Hawaii strategy for plant conservation in our approach to conserving our rare flora. This strategy is modeled after the global strategy for plant conservation, which came out of the Convention on Biological Diversity. So this subspecies, we sometimes just shorthand it to Hibiscus. The Hawaiian name is coauthor. It's federally listed as endangered and assessed on the IUCN Red List of certain species as critically endangered. This taxon is endemic to the island of Hawaii, and currently it's known from three valleys on the north shore: Limahuli, Hanakapiai, and the Hanging Valley of Puhapuau, which is only accessible by helicopter. It's next to Kalalau, the famous Kalalau Valley. And there's about 1 to 150 individuals left in the wild. And I've visited all these populations, and we don't see any signs of regeneration. It's all adult plants, no seedlings. We don't usually see fruits. When we do, the capsules are usually empty, a lot of frass. Sometimes we find seeds, but it's quite rare. They do well from cuttings, though, so we collect from cuttings when we do encounter trees. So although this taxon doesn't have your, you know, classic solid form-shaped corolla of a moth-pollinated species, the white petals, the strong, sweet fragrance, and the fact that the flowers are open at night suggests that it perhaps evolved adaptations to attract moths as pollinators, or has a moth-pollination syndrome. By definition, a pollination syndrome is a suite of floral traits, including rewards, associated with the attraction and utilization of a specific group of animals as pollinators. So I'm sure everybody in this room can raise their hand and answer this question. What is pollination and why is it important? But I often run into this pollination, sometimes, you know, floral visitors or fertilization being lumped into this pollination. So pollination, by definition, simply the transfer of pollen from anther to stigma. There are many other things that have to be just right. The pollen has to be viable. For example, we run into species that have been, we suspect, highly inbred, and we're finding very low amounts of viable pollen, and, or, for example, Brachyrhamium cygnus. And maybe there's some sporophytic or gametophytic incompatibility mechanisms, which Carol just shared with us. And the advantage of animals as pollinators is that it promotes outcrossing. And many Hawaiian plant species rely on pollinators to reproduce. They are self-incompatible physically, and so many will decline and even go extinct if they lose their native pollinators. Human-assisted hand pollination has been necessary to save some Hawaiian plant species from extinction. And some of you may recognize this. This is Steve Coleman, hand pollinating Hamia rockii on the cliffs of Molokai. So using the strategic approach outlined in that strategy, we wrote a fairly small grant to the Mohammed bin Zayed Species Conservation Fund to focus on this rare species. The main objective is to make robust conservation collections. We can maintain ex situ to then outplant in protected and managed habitat. That was one part of this. Another is to conduct a genetic diversity study in collaboration with Chicago Botanic Garden, conduct outplantings, as I mentioned, and then to conduct this green system and pollination. pollination study. So oftentimes, you know, we're trying to augment and save essentially rare species, and we go forward with doing outplantings, but maybe one of the reasons that species is so rare is because it's self-incompatible and it's lost its pollinator and it's not regenerating. So one of the main questions from this conservation management perspective is, does this taxon require a pollinator to reproduce? And what if any species of animals are visiting it and potentially pollinating it? So to address the first question, we utilized our ex situ living collections at Limahuli Garden to conduct the following three pollination treatments and an open control. The open control assessed natural pollination without any manipulations or bagging of the flowers. The outcross treatment, we took pollen from one plant and we tried to use a different accession and deposited on the stigma of a flower on a different plant and bagged that flower to exclude potential pollinators. We did the same for the self-pollinated treatment, but took a flower from that same plant. And then for the bags-only treatment, we bagged flowers in bud and left them to senesce. And very quickly I should mention, we were interested in assessing whether there'd be differences in these treatments for things like fruit set, seed viability. And so very quickly, our methods to assess seed viability, we soaked seeds for 24 hours in water. This was a suggested way of breaking physical dormancy in seeds of Malvaceae. It's been found that a lot of species in this family have physical dormancy. And then we plated them on blotter paper and put them in a germ chamber with a fluctuation of 12 hours of dark at 20 degrees Celsius, 12 hours of light at 30 degrees Celsius. And we checked once per week for germination, which we define as radical emergence. So those little white radicals you see there. And so for fruit set, we found that it was highest in the outcross treatment in the middle and lowest in the bagged only pollinator exclusion treatment. You see that we don't have a control treatment here for fruit set. We have to redo that because we didn't properly label the flowers to track whether or not they aborted. So now we're like flagging the branches and noting which flowers we tagged so we'd be able to track them. And we just redid a bunch of those last week actually. So a few weeks from now, if they set fruit in any of these treatments, we should be collecting the fruits and the seeds. And although this is pretty basic research, I still haven't appropriately figured out how to best analyze it in R, this proportional data. So any suggestions at the end are welcome. For seed viability, we didn't find any significant differences among treatments. So with just these two measures of reproductive success or fitness, whatever you want to call it, looking at that, we might answer that question as to whether this taxon requires a pollinator to reproduce is no, since a fruit did form, one fruit out of 41 bagged, and 100% of the seeds were viable with an N of 6, but there was no significant differences. So to better get at what we're really wanting to know, whether this species does require a pollinator to regenerate, we came up with this other measure of reproductive success we're calling effective fertilization. And it's a percentage, and it's a ratio of the seeds that formed to the maximum available ovules in the flower. So counting a subset of flowers, the number of ovules I found, the maximum amount is 25 per flower, 5 per each of the 5 carpels. And we found that there were significant differences. Effective fertilization was significantly lower in the bagged-only treatment compared to the other two treatments and the open control. And so just looking at this, I should mention these black lines are the median and the pink dots are the mean. So for the outcross treatment, about 40% of the ovules were effectively fertilized and versus bagged-only treatment, 0%. And we took this a small step further. We're calling this effective offspring. So it's a similar pattern here. It's just another way to think about it. It's the ratio of viable seeds that formed to the maximum number of ovules, so only those that germinated. And we have those same differences. And this outlier is neat. For one of the flowers in the open treatment, there's 25 seeds and all of them were viable. So just pointed that out. Seeds per flower, I commonly observe this being reported, and that's the exact same box plots as the effective fertilization, so same pattern. But that percentage was just, I like to think about it that way. And then We didn't see any significant differences between the outcrossed or self-pollinated treatments and any of those other figures. But looking at mean seed mass, we actually did. Mean seed mass was significantly higher in the outcrossed treatment compared to seeds from the self-pollinated treatment. So to address the next question, we conducted pollinator observations also at our Lingley Garden. It's about a 3-hour hike to one of the natural populations in the back of the valley. We did this in 15-minute intervals for over 30 observation hours between fall 2015 and 16, during all times of dawn, day, dusk, and night. And we were most interested in recording the frequency, duration, and fate of any floral visitors. And I haven't crunched this data yet. I'll just be sharing briefly our observations. And we found that the most numerous floral visitors were introduced hawk moths, particularly the pink-spotted hawk moth. You can see here in this photo, here's this particular visitor might be rotten nectar, actually. But we often saw them coming into contact with the stamens and the stigma. Our next step would be to collect these guys and check them for pollen or scales on the stigmas, what have you. We also found numerous nectar thieves. So this is an introduced Japanese wide-eye robbing nectar. So they're accessing it from the backs of the flowers in the circles here. They're not coming into contact with the sexy parts of the flowers. And then introduced ants were also nectar thieves. We don't have any native ants in the Hawaiian Islands. And the introduced honeybees were also robbing nectar. But we sometimes saw them serving as pollinators, but the former behavior was more commonly observed. So to summarize this, does this taxon require a pollinator? Based on whether it's effectively fertilized and there's effective offspring coming from those pollinations, I'd say yes. It was significantly lower in the bagged-only treatment compared to the others and the control. And what, if any, species of animals visiting? Introduced hawk moths are the most numerous flora visitors and do appear to be effective pollinators. Honeybees sometimes do, and there are several introduced nectar robbers. No native floral visitors were observed. So the next step, this summer actually, we're getting up to the upper Limahuli population. It's pretty challenging to get to some of these areas because they're helicopter access only, and a round trip is about $1,200 and weather dependent, what have you. So we're going to do observations at one of these natural populations, and as well, the primary objective is to get conservation collections, to take cuttings and get all of this ex situ. So thank you very much. Thank you to Susan, she's down here, my colleague at NTBD, Dustin, who helped us in the sea lab and the analyses. Donna Boulder was a visiting researcher, and she was interested in coming out to see the hawk moths visiting on election night, actually. So we were out there that whole evening. To our NTBD part interns for helping with the crosses and some observations. BSA for helping bring me here all the way from Hawaii. MBZ for funding, and the Bill Healy Foundation in Kupu for allowing us to house Susan for a whole year. And thank you, everyone, for your attention. Yeah, it'll be interesting. Yeah, I might have been over time, so.